Well, good morning, and good morning to any of our congregation joining us on YouTube. It's lovely to have you with us. I've just managed to press something on my phone and the world has disappeared. Oh, there we are, we've got it back. Yes, welcome to our morning worship. We've been having a discussion around the use of words and language in the church. I used the word liturgy earlier, and Leslie put a question mark about that. So when we say liturgy, we simply mean the words that we use for our service. So there you are, another one of those churchy words, liturgy. The words of the service that we are going to say. Hopefully at home you have your copy of the liturgy that we will be following for this morning. And we share together, and it's lovely to have you with us. So this is a call to worship, and there is a response to the call to worship, which is God was, God is, God will be, God was, God is, and God will be. So feel free to join in, and do feel free to join in here in the church. In the beginning, before time, before people, before the world began, God was. Here and now, among us, beside us, enlisting the people of earth for the purposes of heaven, God is. In the future, where we have turned to dust and all we know has found its fulfillment, God will be. Not denying the world, but delighting in it. Not understanding the world, but redeeming it. Through Jesus Christ, by the power of the Holy Spirit, God was, God is, God will be. We're going to have our first hymn, and I'm afraid our singers are having quite a task this morning, our singers, because we have a lot of music, because we're going to have some singing during the communion as well, but we have There's a Spirit in the Air. Apparently I'm going to join Ruth for this one, so the sound team are now going to panic. Thank you very much. Beautiful. In a moment, we're going to have our reading, and Sue's going to come and read for us. I would just say that on that topic of language and language that makes sense to us, Ruth and I were discussing this yesterday. We think, I've never been formally diagnosed, but I'm pretty sure I'm dyslexic. And one of the things I find is that language looks different on paper than it does, say, on a screen. And I've been trying to teach myself to read it off of the screen because it means I get to talk to the people at home on the camera better. But my head rearranges the words. And one of the things I get is that I see the words I want to see and not the words that are actually there, which I think is not particularly helpful. Anyway, this morning's reading taken from John.
Jesus, the true vine. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. Amen.
Thank you. A simple concept described in terms that probably, if you're a gardener, make absolute sense. That a plant doesn't grow without being rooted in something. Branches do not exist on their own, they come out of a stem, and that stem in our case is the love of God through Jesus Christ. Jesus is the vine, the true vine, from which everything grows, and we are rooted in God. It's a lovely, but it's a very poetic concept, but the words aren't that complicated. I guess abide is one that we don't use very often, but to be in God, to be with God, to be in connection. We love the word connection in the Methodist Church, don't we? We are in connection. We are in connection with Christ. We are rooted in Christ. It's a lovely reading. Let us pray and offer ourselves to God in prayer. Lord God, Almighty Father and Creator, the vine in which we are grounded, the ground in which we are planted. Lord, help us to grow in you. We look at the wonder and beauty of your creation. We look at all the things that you have made in all their glorious diversity. We look at all the challenges that the world brings. And Lord, we ask that you bless us with your continued love and presence. Lord, we are in awe of what you have done for us, but we are aware that we haven't always treated your world the way that we should. We haven't always treated one another the way that we should. Lord, sometimes we have used your words for our own benefit and for power. Lord, we have sometimes not treated each other with kindness and love. Sometimes we have deliberately not understood what you're trying to say to us. And sometimes, Lord, we have simply got lost and wandered from the path. So in the quiet, Lord, we bring before you our apology. We ask for forgiveness. We bring before you the things that we have done and regret, the things that we haven't done and should have, and the things that we simply held up like a barrier pretending you didn't exist. And Lord, we pray, knowing that you are a loving and merciful God, that you have promised us that when we come to you, that by some mysterious means, our sins are forgiven and the slate is wiped clean. And for this we praise you and thank you. Amen. In a moment, we're going to have our next hymn. I just noticed that there was a few more greetings that had come in this morning. So as we just before we have our next hymn, just a quick greeting. Eugenia, Sam and Lee down in Wales, lovely to have you with us. Madeline Freelove. So Jill Walker, good morning. Caroline Metam, lovely to have you with us. Elizabeth, good to have you with us. So greetings, and if I haven't said hello to you this morning, I will do so after the service and greet you online. So we sing together our second hymn, and in preparation for communion, just to explain, if you're at home and you're doing your agape, make sure that you've got to hand your drink and something to eat so you've got something to share when we share together. Chocolate cake is always advised. And for people here in the congregation, you stay where you are. I will say the words here, put on my mask, and then bring the elements to you. And then I'll come back here and say, let us eat. And then let us drink, and we will do that as separate things. And you join in with that, and then Jeremy will collect up the glasses afterwards. Okay, so that's how it's going to work, and we now have our communion hymn. Thank you to our wonderful music team this morning. It's such a privilege to have music here in the worship, and we look forward to those days when we can sing together again. Of course, you can all sing at home, and I hope you're joining in. Our prayers of thanksgiving and intercession. Eternal God, I give thanks this day for the beauty of the earth and the wonder of life. I give thanks for the changing of the seasons and the movement of the stars. I give thanks for Jesus, my rock and my friend. Bless your world this day, I pray, and use me to do your acts of discipleship in it. Be with those who are hungry and do not know the luxury of 3 square meals, complete with snacks in between and as many hot drinks as I like. Be with those who are fighting COVID and are fearful about their health. Be with those who are fighting addictions and help me to be wary of things by which I can fall addicted. Be with those who are facing violence on a battlefield or near their own homes. Bless every human being, I pray, with grace enough and faith enough to bring them home to you now and forever. For I say it and I mean it in Jesus' name, who taught me to pray, and we say together the Lord's Prayer. Loving God, from whom creation flows, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us nourishment this day for body and soul, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. If you're following your orders of service at home, or even here in the building, you'll note that we were talking before the service about the use of language, and we were saying that there's so many words for communion, for the breaking of the bread. And ultimately, we remember the sacrifice of Jesus Christ in the breaking of the bread and the sharing of wine. We don't necessarily need all these complicated words. In this particular liturgy, we have the Holy Eucharist, it says at the start. But it's the same thing. The Holy Eucharist is the breaking of the bread and the sharing in the wine. If you're at home and you're doing it informally, we refer to it as an agape or a love feast. So to start our Eucharist, I will lead, and there is a response, which is, God is the hand that created you. And this is just to illustrate that God is the God of all things, that there is nothing that is outside God. There's nothing excluded. Everything is included in God's love. In the beginning, God made the world, all that is green, blue, deep, and growing. God's is the hand that created you. All that is tender, firm, fragrant, and curious, God's is the hand that created you. All that crawls, flies, swims, walks, or is motionless, God's is the hand that created you. All that speaks, sings, cries, laughs, or keeps silence, God is the hand that created you. All that suffers, lacks, limps, or longs for an end, God's is the hand that created you. The world belongs to God. God's is the hand that created you. Therefore, we join our voices with those of all creation in the unending hymn of praise. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. We talked also earlier about God being found sometimes in the places, the unusual places, in the places of change, in the edge places. And you'll see that referred to as we go forward. God is not just the God of the expected, but the unexpected. A God who sees and experiences change. Before going out into the wilderness of the garden, Jesus sat down to eat and drink with his friends, to show them the challenge of the way ahead. and offer them gifts for that journey. He took bread, sustaining and wholesome, and poured wine, earthy and warming, and sharing these as signs of his continuing presence with them throughout time to come. God of the edge places, send down upon us now and on these gifts of bread and wine that same Spirit who drove Jesus into the desert, that we too may be tempered and strengthened by your presence and refreshed and renewed through your love. And now, recognizing that that love's promise is also for us in this time and place, we too break bread and pour wine to share with one another. And in that action, we recognize and affirm with joy that Christ is present with us now in this place and throughout time to come. This is the place where we are made well again. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. The tent side is open. The table is set. God waits for us to come in from the desert and be refreshed. This table is open and all are welcome to join in here. I will bring the elements round and our lovely music folk are going to lead us in some songs as we share together. His body broken for you. Oh, I forgot our musicians. Hang on. So that wouldn't be a very inclusive message just to leave them out, would it, after all of that? His body broken for you, take and eat. His blood shed for you, take and drink. Let us share together in the prayer after communion. Again, it has a response. God has called us to journey for a season through the wilderness places. And so, as Jesus did before us, we will set out once more to wander in uncomfortable landscape and wrestle with its challenges, that through the tempering action of the Spirit, we may emerge ready to do the work of the kingdom. For bread and wine, this place and this time, thanks be to God. For the peace we are promised, which the world won't destroy, thanks be to God. For the hope of heaven on earth and the final song of joy, thanks be to God. Amen. So I hope that you've been able to share together with us at home. We're coming to our final hymn. I will send some messages afterwards. I've seen there's lots of messages on the feed, on our Facebook feed. But we have been able to break bread and share together in this act of worship today. And hopefully, with many, many more of you at home in all sorts of different places, and it's been a joy to have you with us. As we come to our final hymn, I think Ruth is going to give me permission to actually come and sing with her on this one. So I'm allowed to join in this one. So we're going to sing together our final hymn, number 317, and to our congregation here who've been so lovely and patient and who have to sit through all of this. At the end, we will stand to do the grace so that at least you get to move. But all they can do is mumble into their masks when it comes to the hymns. It's so unfair. So we will sing together our final hymn, 317, At the Name of Jesus. I do like that hymn, I have to say. A prayer of blessing. Bless us, Lord, as we seek to see that which is beautiful in the changing seasons and seek to do that which is faithful in the passing of time. Amen. And so if you would like to do so, you're welcome to stand. I'm sorry we can't yet hold hands, but we can reach out to one another and we can share together in the words of the grace. Let's say the grace together. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
One walk with you, may the greeting one stand by. more.